My Lord Owunyi Doro is not qualified to sit in this matter by virtue of his prior engagements and therefore prevented from being sufficiently impartial to adjudicate the petition at hand. The court was hired by the first respondent in the head petition, Yoweri Museveni, as his lawyer, advocate. In paragraphs 5 and 8 of the supplementary affidavit and annex thereto, I've just demonstrated that actually the conduct in 2006 elections is an issue in this case. Prove that indeed the CJ has consistently met the first respondent and the public is aware of the same. So those are the facts before you. A judge shall disqualify himself or herself from participating in any proceedings which a judge is unable to decide the matter impartially or which may appear to a reasonable observer that the judge is unable to decide the matter impartially.
Well argued. Now, for reasons I will give in my detailed ruling to be delivered on notice, I decline to recuse. I find no merit in the application. You can now proceed on the other grounds of your...
But as I told you, when you decline, then my other grounds fall.
Well, then you tell us what you want to do with them.
They fall. You have made them fall.
So what do you want to do with them? They've fallen, yes. Do you want to collect them from the ground and pocket them or what? What do you want to do?
I shall leave them there until I get what to do.
And my name is Nkomisha. You had earlier was speaking to Jacob Sininyi, who's the PRO of the Internal Affairs / Immigration Offices. Now, right now, we're talking about the Chagulanyi petition, one of those trending stories worldwide, I must say. The new development is that yesterday, the court, the Chief Justice said he cannot recuse himself from the petition because he was rightfully appointed and he went through the process, the entire process. So that is one. Two, today they are in the Supreme Court. I hope that Chagulanyi is actually expected to forward the withdrawal request. I don't know if they call it a request, but this is why I have the legal people with me today to understand those things. Joining me is the Public Relations Officer, Judiciary, that is Solomon Muita. Good morning and welcome to the show.
Good morning.
And next to him is a political scientist at the Chambogo University, and that is Sultan Kakuba. Sebo, you're welcome.
Thank you.
It's not the first time we're having you here. It's
no,
good to have you.
Yes, severally.
Absolutely.
Good morning to you and the very good morning to our viewers.
Absolutely. We're good to have you, gentlemen. Let me start with Solomon here. Solomon, with all the issues going on, the petition was filed and they wanted to add a few things in the petition, it was thrown out, then they wanted there was another request that was thrown out, they wanted to add other affidavits, they were thrown out. This case looked very funny from comments we've had around. It looked funny. Is that so?
I don't think so. Mm. I don't see anything terribly different from the many other cases we handle in the courts, including petitions of the same kind.
Yes.
Yeah, applications come, miscellaneous applications are filed. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they are accepted by the courts, sometimes they are rejected.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing different.
So different.
Yeah. What is different is that this time we have a case and we have a petitioner consistently addressing the media about the petition.
Right.
That is new.
That is.
Yeah, that is new.
Yes.
Otherwise, the legal gymnastics in court, there is nothing new.
There's
about
nothing
it.
New.
Yeah, there is, it's not the first time someone puts in an application and is rejected.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the first time someone asks court for extension of time.
Yeah.
It's not the first time someone tells court that they want to bring in new evidence.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not the first time that court says, no, we are not granting that.
Okay.
So
apart from addressing the
media, the only difference
the media,
is the talk outside the court.
I will come to that. What effects does that have? I want to hear from you, Doctor. He says it is not any different, but people are saying there's a lot of bias around it. He's actually calling on the Supreme Court justices, calling them biased. It is already biased. It was a biased right from the start. Have we seen that before? But and then how did we move?
Thank you very much. In my opinion, Solomon could be right. What I observe and what I see which is lacking is that when court says no, we are not accepting, there must be a reason, and this reason must be given, and the public should know the reason. And Honorable Kyagulanyi is capitalizing on that. You are saying is in the media, because court has not come out to bring out the reason why they are rejecting his requests, and he is now resorting to media that maybe he may be heard. So, in my opinion, the court must come out.
So why did he go to court if he wanted court to address his issues?
You see, in a democratic system, there are institutions.
Mm.
And in this case, we have legislature, the judiciary, and the role of the judiciary is to adjudicate.
Yeah.
And he went there to seek for justice,
mm-hmm.
which he feels that he has gotten some injustice somewhere. Things went wrong. And from his observation, says that there must be something wrong.
Mm-hmm.
When he makes a request, that request is not honored. But to me, I think court must be coming out transparent. It must be in a transparent manner.
How do you describe your transparency?
Transparency
because
is
for
that...
him, I think he's describing his transparency as being out there in the media.
No. You see, judiciary has a spokesperson
who is here. Yes.
When you decide on an issue,
mm-hmm.
and it is in the public interest, he must communicate to the public.
Solomon. Is that true? Are you here to tell us those things?
Yeah, part of my duty includes informing the public what is going on.
On the progress.
But I do not make decisions or pronouncements of court to the public. That's not my duty.
Right.
That duty is for the court itself. I can disseminate
mm-hmm.
what they decide. The issue my brother is talking about of the court giving reasons. Yes, a litigant is entitled to all the information he requires for the case. But in such a case, with lots of parties, lots of documentations, and lots of information, sometimes the court can give the decision and delay the reasoning. Reason is, the reasoning could be so detailed and the time within which they are operating does not afford them the luxury of putting all the reasons together so they can always give the decision and then defer the reasoning.
Okay.
This is not the first time it's happening. I think in the past, I think even in all the petitions, election, the presidential elections petition, the court comes, gives a decision, and then it says in 90 days we'll come back with
the detailed
reasoning.
Mm-hmm.
It happens. It also happened in the so-called age limit petition.
Petition.
Yeah.
Yes.
The give the decision a summary of what they've decided.
Mm-hmm.
And then later they'll come with a 200-page judgment or 300-page. They can read it the whole day.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now, right now, in these applications, What is important is for the petitioner to know that this was the application. They want to bring in more affidavits, and the court says, no, we are not letting you, but we will tell you why later.
Absolutely.
So in the interest of time, you know the decision, and it can help you plan for the next thing without the court and the parties losing a lot of time going about. Because in any case, this is the Supreme Court. Even if you got to know all the reasons now, you're not going to file an appeal. You don't have anywhere else to go
to file an
appeal. So it's a matter of knowing.
He mentioned,
but you're going to know.
He would appeal in the public court. Anyway, you mentioned he goes to the media, and in most of the legal documents I've come across, the media and court proceedings don't always mix. Does his pronunciations of being in the media, talking about this, I'm doing that, does it have any effect on a case, for example?
Very much. That's why sometimes even here courts. Or invoking what we call the sub judice rule, you know, it is there for a purpose, because they know that anything discussed out there about a live case that can influence the mind of the judge shouldn't happen. So if you engage in a discussion, and that discussion can result into maybe the judge saying, oh, I think I got it wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I think I should do this. You know, that is so wrong. So it is discouraged. There is a law that prevents that.
Mm.
Yes.
Interesting.
It hasn't been invoked so far, but it can be. So it is so wrong, and we keep telling these politicians that now you're before the court. You decided to come before the court. Give the court a chance. Give it time. Let it give you a decision. After a decision comes, you can go and discuss all you want.
Mm.
But give the court a chance.
Absolutely.
Because if you didn't want to give the court a chance,
then you
why did you even come? If you think from the onset, if you think getting justice from this court is far-fetched, why do you even waste time to come?
Absolutely. I like that you point that out. I want to ask, Doctor, we have seen that previously, before this election, actually, the general election, Honorable Kyagulanyi has been in courts about 3 times before this petition, and he has won some of these cases. Why now is he saying that the highest court in the land cannot deliver a free and fair judgment?
I think Kyagulanyi in some situation is moving fast.
Mm.
He needs to
slow down.
First of all, he took an initiative to go to court.
Right.
And by going to court, he knew very well that he was going to get justice. And therefore, he should give court the opportunity to do its work. But he has been coming up with so many allegation claims, for example, requesting some judges to rescue themselves from, I think this one comes as a result of lack of trust in our institutions.
Yes.
And the trust in our institutions comes with how individuals in those individual officers in these institutions work. They must build the trust in this institution so that when you go there, you are very sure that you will achieve your objective of going there.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in this case, for example, Honorable Kyagulanyi requested, I think, Chief Justice to rescue himself, saying he was a lawyer of the president and all these things. In my opinion, I think
this is a process. Chief Justice could have been a lawyer of the president, but it is time now this case to test judiciary whether they work or they act professionally. And Chief Justice could have come out clearly to explain or to give reasons why he can, and I think he has tried to do that. I don't know whether he has been able to convince, but it seems he has not been able to convince Honorable Chagulan. That's why he has gone ahead to withdraw the case, because he feels he will not get there.
I don't think that's the reason. For starters, Honorable Chagulani asked the Chief Justice and two other justices to recuse themselves from a press briefing. Now, there are procedures that have to be followed in a court process.
I was coming there.
I'm only responding because you're saying.
I was coming there. When he made a request, like I said earlier, Honorable Chagulani is moving fast. He needs to slow down. When you request,
he wasn't given enough time for all these things.
No, now when his petition was accepted, I think the court has now a process, and they have a time frame in which they operate. So he would have given court time to take its course, because he's missing a point. When he moves faster, there is a point he's missing. Because he will not actually get a clear picture on how he would have, gotten justice in his case.
Okay.
Because he would have gone through processes for
the rightful process.
Yeah, rightful process. So that this is a way for someone to excuse or to rescue from the process.
Mm.
He would have requested for that. But he moved fast.
He needed to do it formally.
Did
yes.
he?
He didn't. He hasn't.
The problem.
So what implications does this have?
No, what we are seeing is more of political talk. Well, one thing he has now done the right way. He has filed an application to withdraw the case this morning. This morning.
That's a very interesting. We're coming to that.
Less than an hour ago.
Wow.
But remember, he made the statements on Monday. So
he had all that
time. So, first of all, the public out there got wrong information, that even the media reported that he has withdrawn the case. But the process has just started a few minutes ago. Now, he has to serve. The court has to set a hearing date. The matter has to be argued in court,
Solomon,
and so on.
We have seen that throughout this petition, since he filed the petition, he has talked a lot about bias and bias and bias. Is judicial bias a problem?
Yes, it is, and it can be a problem. But you need to have evidence when you claim it. We know that many people who come to our courts, whenever things don't go their way, it's like football. Let me use football as an example.
Right.
Arsenal versus Man U. Now, when Man U beats Arsenal, an Arsenal fan can conveniently say the referee is biased. Oh, the referee...
They mentioned that a
lot. Yeah, they say that a lot, that he was paid off. But ask them who paid, where did it happen, how did it happen, they will not tell you. So, same thing, people who come to court are so quick to say that the judge is biased. But we also, the same people can be reminded that there is a due process that can be taken to handle a judge who is biased. We have very many institutions where you can take information and a judge can be dealt with. You can go to the police, IGG, you can go to the Chief Justice, you can go to any cabinet minister, you can go to Judicial Service Commission, you can go to the Inspectorate of Courts. There are so many places to go.
Mm-hmm.
But people don't even attempt to go there. But they are quick to get in front of the camera and say, they are biased, they are biased. Ask them, if you're a leader and you're a responsible leader, why are you not helping the public if you know that Judge X, Judge Y is biased, is working against the oath, the judicial oath he took? Why don't you help the public by providing that information to the institutions that can deal with this judge and get him out of the system? Why do you want to just make statements and leave it there?
Everything, law, legal, there are processes,
yes,
due processes to follow.
Exactly.
You don't just go to the media and open your mouth and start saying things that might actually affect your case. All right, I need us to take a break. When we return, Solomon here, who is the PR for the judiciary, has told us that this morning is when Chagulanyi actually filed, what do they call it? A withdrawal?
It's an application.
An application to withdraw the case. Chances are he might be allowed to withdraw, he might not be allowed to withdraw. Those two have implications. I want to know, where are we headed after this? We'll be back. Welcome back to Kachae with me and Solomon Muita. He is the PR of the judiciary, and of course Dr. Sultan Kakua is a political scientist at Chambogo University. Chagulanyi this morning and his team, according to Solomon here, has just filed his request.
Application.
My God, why do I keep forgetting that? Application to withdraw the case. Remember Monday he addressed the media and said that he's withdrawing, has instructed his people to withdraw the case. Question is, there are implications. There are very many implications, I would imagine. What does this mean for the people, right? What does this mean for the judiciary? What does this mean for the country at large? Because it means, and what happens? Before I went for a break, I asked, so now he has filed an application. What happens?
The rules are clear. When you file, you have to serve the respondents.
Right.
In this case, we have President-elect Yoweri Museveni. We have Electoral Commission and the Attorney General.
Right.
They have to be served. Well, luckily, they are going to be at the court this morning. So from the registry, he can serve them.
All right.
But they may ask for maybe a day or so to go through the application, and they either file a response or they will come and respond in court.
Mm-hmm.
The court has to set a hearing date for that application.
To hear that application.
Yes. And the rules say the respondents have a right to oppose it.
Oh.
Yes. So they can choose to oppose, or they can just say, it's okay, you go.
Okay, should they choose to oppose it? That is where that is what I want.
Yes.
Should they choose to oppose it, what happens?
Well, the court will listen. The court will listen, because when you oppose, you have reasons. You're going to advance that, you know, we got involved in lots of preparation. Maybe Electoral Commission will say the public should know what exactly happened if they think they did the right thing. And the petitioner was saying they did so many wrong things.
Mm-hmm.
EC may say the public should not be denied the opportunity to know what exactly happened. Let them know what happened. So bring your evidence, we put in our response, and the public will follow everything.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the process, people should not doubt what happened.
Right.
So that could be a reason. I'm not speculating what they are going to say.
Of course.
But the president-elect may also say people should know that I was validly elected.
And
so give them a chance to confirm that. If I wasn't,
mm-hmm,
maybe the court can cancel the election.
Mm-hmm.
So all those arguments can come, and at the end of the day, the court has to make a decision. So if where the court decides to allow the petitioner or the person applying to get out of the case to get out. The rules say he suffers the burden of paying the costs to the other, to the respondents.
Mm-hmm.
So the court will have to go through that process. The respondents have to file in court how much they've incurred
mm-hmm.
In research, in you know, instructions and so on. And then we go through what we call a taxation process. They come and now discuss the bills.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, is it exorbitant? Is it fair? And the person who is supposed
to... They are ready for anything.
Yeah, they are ready, but yeah, even that readiness has to be tested in court.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Doctor, do you think the withdrawal of this petition is a test on democracy? You are a political scientist.
Yes, I want to say that they withdraw if it succeeds, because the court has to pronounce itself.
Of course.
It is a test on our democracy
mm-hmm.
because it signals mistrust in a democratic institution like the judiciary. Because now he's withdrawing and going back to the people.
Mm-hmm.
And the people, you will find the two sides. They are those who are going to agree with the Honorable Chagulani that yes, you were right to withdraw the case. They are those who are going to oppose. And this one puts our democracy in a question. In a democratic system, people must have the opportunity to access services, express themselves, and there is nothing like, you know, I'm with it. Even when you are withdrawing, it is within, you know, the interests of the public and people accept, but it is like a protest.
Mm.
And this one, there is need for government to actually carry out civic education, because the way it is going to be interpreted by the public is going to be different.
Very different, yes.
So, do they understand what he...
But doctor, right from the start, if you listen to what Chagulani said on Monday, he said that right from the start, this court was biased against his petition, right from the word go. Does this also mean that he does not believe in the democratic tenets of the country?
I think this was Chagulani's opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you say court is biased, you must come out with concrete evidence which is proved beyond reasonable doubt. And what you are saying, let the public say that now they are imposing certain things.
But you see, what he says also affects what people think. The people who are hoping in the petition are going to say, oh, well, it is biased, it is bad, because the petitioner himself thinks the court is biased.
That's why I said the public has two sides. There are those one who are going to agree with him that, look, he has given A, B, C, D, court has not accepted, so it's biased.
Mm.
There are those who are going to say, no, he would have left the court to proceed and make a decision. But of course, we have already precedent. You know very well.
You mentioned that one. I want to come to that as well. Yes.
Yes, we have a precedent that retired the Colonel Dr. Kizza Besigye was in court.
Mm.
Honorable Amam Mbabazi was in court,
yes.
And the court made a decision. And of course, the conclusion, there was laments, you know, there was laments that, you know, court does not do its work
mm-hmm.
to the expectations of the public. So if you have a biased mind, you cannot accept. So that's why I'm saying the government has a duty, has a responsibility to make citizens have trust in the institution, let them have a culture of accepting the due process of, say, the judiciary and other activities.
Absolutely.
So this is a challenge to our democracy.
Okay. Now, we are live, by the way. We are live on Facebook. If you go to Urban Television, we are live there. And now I get a comment from a one at Haile Paul. He says, this time around, the judiciary has been exposed. Leveled bias, premeditated subjudice, conflict of interest. And I think, Solomon, you need to explain to me, what is all this? Why are people, why do you, well, is the judiciary on a test? Are we seeing the judiciary
well,
being tested?
Well, we operate in the open. We are out there. We are out there. Everything we do, people follow, minute by minute. And we are not worried about that. This morning, I've just shared links to the public on Twitter, on our official Twitter account, for the public out there to follow the proceedings in court. Because we want to be as open as possible. We want everyone to follow the proceedings in court where they cannot go physically.
Right.
And we have so many cameras at court to give them the proceedings. We know that every time we open our doors, someone out there is auditing our processes.
That's true.
So we try to give it our best. However, we also know that the two parties that come before us, at the end of the day, one will be victorious and one will lose out.
Mm.
We also know that it is common for the losers to find a reason they'll always find something to say to explain the loss.
Mm-hmm.
That is common. But we also know that, at least from research, 85% of the people who use our courts have a lot of trust in the courts, and they would recommend a friend or a colleague to court.
Go to court.
That is, if you read the reports of Hill, Hill is a Dutch justice institution. It does a lot of research in justice and innovation around justice. So every year they produce reports. Majority of the people who say they do not trust the courts have never gone to court, according to research.
Oh.
The people who have interfaced with the courts, who have had cases in court, actually trust the courts. Mm. So much of the talk we hear, but we know the truth. We know that every year, the cases we receive increase.
So Solomon,
yes.
Let's look at this particular presidential election petition. Would you say that the Supreme Court and its justices are on trial? Because, I mean, everyone is pointing fingers at them.
You see, the expectations, public expectations, are high.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't call it a try.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We know that expectations are high because people have interest in this. This is, we are talking about auditing the election of the most important person in the land,
right.
Citizen number one. So everyone has interest in, even the people who didn't, who are not even closer to the people petitioning or the people responding, they have interest, even people out of the country. So we know, but you know, the quality of the justices in the Supreme Court is up there. These are people.
The cream.
Yeah. These are people who have been in this profession for an average of 20 years, an average. They've been there. They've handled so many cases. They've been tested. Before these people go to that court, they have to go through so many sieves. And
which the CJ actually highlighted,
yes,
yesterday in response to...
You see, you go through Judicial Service Commission. They test you. They even go and ask your peers about you, your character, your conduct, your professionally, how, you know, you've performed out there. They test, they check so many things about you before forwarding your name, and they interview you. before forwarding your name to the president.
Mm.
After that, the name is forwarded to parliament
for vetting.
All these politicians have to review your file and they invite you, they interact with you. By the time they approve you, they are sure that you're the right man or woman for the job.
It's actually something that the Chief Justice talked about yesterday in
and
response to
half of the team sitting on this current petition has actually been involved in previous petitions of the same nature.
That's true.
So these are not, you know, there's nothing so new about what they are handling, what they are dealing with.
Doctor, what do you have to say? People are pointing fingers at the CJ, the Chief Justice, and they keep saying, why is he constantly updating us? Why is he reacting to these allegations or to whatever they throw at him? And also, let us look at the Supreme Court versus the Court of Public Opinion. You're a political scientist. You have seen these things previously. You actually teach people about these things. Chagulanyi withdrawing this case and highlighting all the issues he has highlighted, taking this to the Court of Public Opinion. What effects are we looking at there?
Okay, I would look at from the perspective, the finger which they are pointing at Chief Justice, I think, in my opinion, it is the way the Chief Justice is appointed.
Mm.
You know, the president appoints.
But they go through a system.
They go through a system. But a head of state has more power.
That's right.
If a head of state nominates you, you know, and then I nominate someone, and you go to a process, the chances that his candidate will go through are higher. So I think people are pointing at the Chief Justice because of that process. If the process of appointing a Chief Justice had no hand of the president, I think even Chagulanyi wouldn't be raising all this dust that you see Chief Justice is biased and all this. So coming to the implication Supreme Court versus
Court of the Public or Public Court
is, like I said earlier, mistrust in the judiciary, and this one now, people now have to decide what to do.
Mm-hmm.
That now it is us who made the decision, and we are not comfortable with the judiciary, that they will not make a decision that will be in our interest. Now, which way
do we go?
So now the public, this is now the state, and I believe now the state is working to monitor what happens.
Absolutely, after this.
And even supporters of Honorable Chagulanyi, they must be asking him questions. What next?
Mm.
So, public court and the state, they are now getting prepared on what's next. Exactly.
Solomon, earlier on before the show, we also discussed that the withdrawal of this petition has implications. One, I also want us to get to the cost implications of withdrawing a case. But this particular one, Can court continue hearing without the petitioners in this case? Imagine that happened. And how would that be?
All I know is the law allows a substitution of the petitioner. So if one of the candidates in the presidential elections, they just concluded elections, picks interest and applies to take over the case, because they can say that now that Mr. Chagulanyi is withdrawing, for me, I want to take it forward. They could approach the court, and the court would have to make a decision on that. So if it's substituted, it could proceed.
Interesting.
It could
proceed. Where does the expert
expert proceedings may arise? The circumstances may be different.
Okay.
in case like today,
yes,
the court was scheduled to continue with the pre-hearing conference.
Yes.
If the court convenes and one party does not appear, the other party may apply to court that they knew about this date, they didn't turn up, they didn't even write to court, they are wasting court's time. For us, we are ready to proceed. The court may make a ruling that, okay, let's proceed ex parte. Like one-sided, really.
Ah, okay.
Yes.
Okay,
but where sense. There is an application for withdrawal, you yes. can't say, let them go and we proceed.
Oh, yeah.
No, that would be funny. That would be funny.
That would, okay.
Yeah.
Now, let's look at the cost implications of withdrawing a case.
The costs are not prescribed anywhere. They are not. What happens? Hiring lawyers is just like going to hospital. Or, you know, when you go to hospital one morning, you may not know whether you should carry 10,000 or 500,000 or 1,000,000. You may not exactly know. Different lawyers charge differently. They charge their clients differently. So some people can get a lawyer for 100,000, but there are lawyers who are hired for 100,000,000. So what the court just asks the beneficiary from the costs to file their bill.
Ah.
They will file. And from practice, you get to know that if it's so high, it may be this. If it's so low, it may be this. So when they file in court and they file on the party that is supposed to pay. And then when we go for what we call taxation, it's like a hearing, but discussing the bill.
Does that affect me as a person, perhaps interested in the case, or?
Yeah, if the court decides that you have to pay the other party,
yeah.
It definitely affects you because you have to. The order is against you to pay. It means you have to look for the money and pay. If you don't pay, then there are other processes, execution of that order.
Mm.
They will go through all sorts of things, which may include attaching. Your property your if you promises. Can't find the money. But at the taxation hearing,
yeah.
The party that is supposed to pay will come up and oppose some of the figures.
Of course.
They will say, no, this is exorbitant. Yeah. Because you may put in your bill that we sent a team to...
For research.
We sent a team to America to study how Trump did it. Now someone may say, no, there is no evidence that you traveled.
Right.
So that one gets out.
Okay.
Oh,
okay.
Even if you traveled, that was
so
a laser
also a hearing
trip.
It wasn't.
Yeah,
so
it's a hearing.
Absolutely.
So the parties have to look at each figure.
And the judiciary, how were they affected?
No, the judiciary doesn't get affected at all in this transaction. Because it's just an arbiter.
Okay.
It's listening and helping them, you know, when parties argue and that this is exorbitant, the court can agree with that position and say, no, that figure should be lowered from maybe 50 million to 10 million.
Okay.
And then the court has to make a ruling on that, and that is what is registered.
Right. Doctor, we are out of time, but in conclusion, in the event that court allows, for example, the withdrawal application to go through. Precedents, let's talk about the precedent set. What does it mean?
When a court accepts to withdraw the petition, now the public court, which Chagulan is now presenting his case, when we look at the election of 1980, when the current president was not satisfied with the result, of course he also went court and decided to mobilize some people, and he said the best way to get rid of these injustices is to mobilize people and fight, and you know, through war, he got power.
Now, we are watching, like I said, the state is watching, and the public court. What is it going to do next?
Okay.
And this is now what we are watching.
Mm.
And we need to think outside the box that what we should really be thinking, not to to create, for example, riots, violence, and all, because the public now, they are going to decide. So though the law, for example, gives the citizen the right to demonstrate.
That's right.
I think sometimes it is misused.
Okay.
A demonstration sometimes in this country results into riot.
Okay.
And so sometimes, to some extent,
yeah.
Sometimes, you know, the way our police conducts itself triggers, you know. So
okay, Doctor.
This is where we are heading now, to wait
Solomon,
to see.
Yes. Jurisprudence-wise, what does it set any precedence?
Yeah, it.
And we are concluding.
Well, it does. This hasn't. This would be the first time this happens at that level. All the petitions we've had have been argued to the end.
Mm-hmm.
So this would be the first time it happens. I know it will become a case study to all these law schools.
Yeah.
They will have to they will keep referring to this case.
Absolutely.
Whichever way it goes, this, you know, with this application.
Mm.
Yeah, but I wanted to comment something briefly about what you said about the public court.
Mm-hmm.
You know, public court is just you and me out there.
Yeah.
I saw a cartoon yesterday, an interesting cartoon, that, you know, having so many border men sitting on their borders that they are now waiting for Honorable Kyagulanyi to bring the evidence to them and they start analyzing the evidence. It's so interesting.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but that is very expensive.
Oh.
The public court.
Super expensive.
Super costly. This is so fair.
Really?
So, yeah. You see, when you're going to realize that it's expensive,
uh-huh.
when people start doing things that are not accepted in the law, or illegal things, protests,
they come at a cost.
Yes.
They come at a cost, and that's very right.
So we would really advise people to cautiously move there.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Very fantastic. Thank you very much, Solomon Mwita. But allow me, and also Dr. Kakuba Sultan, thank you very much for making time. But as we wind up, let me read this comment. Latif Fakai says, Dolo, referring to the Chief Justice, Owinyi Dolo, was intimidating Kyagulanyi instead, good enough. Ask the public court, we are ready. At a cost. What I actually wanted to ask Solomon, but we're out of time, is there a possibility that the Chief Justice can move out of this case, and then what happens if he does? But it's too late. He says he cannot recuse himself. And if I'm to re-echo the president of the Legal Society words, she says it would be quite a precedent. That is Fiona Wall. She says it would be quite a precedent, but I'm hoping it will not set the precedence that people will not believe in the Supreme Court because it is the highest court of the land. Thank you very much, gentlemen, and thank you for keeping us company here at Urban Today. We'll definitely catch you again tomorrow. Take care of yourselves. Watch out for the proceedings. Solomon has shared links. You need to follow up
on
that
Twitter.
Case on the
judiciary
Twitter page. Follow up on the links and know what's happening before you go to the public court. Okay? Stay focused. We wish you a very wonderful Wednesday.